At MVUUC, we seek inspiration and meaning from a great many faith traditions and philosophies. We support each other's lifelong spiritual journey, and we encourage work for justice and peace. We value open minds and loving hearts. Here, may our minds stretch, our hearts open, and our spirits deepen.
We want to do our opening song. I think we omitted.
Not quite.
Okay.
Please take a moment to think of all your friends at MVUUC. Greet them here, in person, or in a comment in the chat box if you're on Zoom. Let us support one another. We can do it right now.
So better late than never, let's do our opening song. Whoever you are, we welcome you.
The chalice will be lit today by Susan Rogers. Please join me in reading these words by Gordon B. McKeeman for the lighting of the chalice. They appear as a comment in the chat box. Deep calls unto deep. Joy calls unto joy. Light calls unto light. Let the kindling of this flame rekindle in us the inner light of love, of peace, of hope, and as one flame lights another, nor grows the less, we pledge ourselves to be bearers of the light wherever we are. Y'all will have to bear with me. I haven't done this in more than 2 years, so.
All right. Hello, everyone. I'm Tina Jones. I'm usually the one sitting over there, but I am grateful for this opportunity today to help you and me learn a little bit more about joy. I wanted to go over. Oh, thanks, Megan. One more. There we go. So, as you will hear me discuss during the reflection, music can be a direct path to joy, which is my topic today. I use music to find joy nearly every day, including in my role as an elementary school teacher. I figured that while the kids are still with us, we'd start the service by having a mini dance party. I'd like for the kids, if you feel like it, come on up and you can dance with us, and any adults who are moved to do so, you might just want to clap along or sway in your seat. All of that is welcome. The main thing is to enjoy the music and to notice the feeling of well-being that is created by the music. And once it starts.
So we've got one more musical bit with the kids.
Good job,
Megan,
everyone.
If you would jump out of PowerPoint into the browser for a second, we've got the lyrics for Let's Go Fly a Kite. So, yeah, I don't know if Megan heard. Megan, could you jump into the browser for a second? I've got the lyrics up there. So, we're also going to do a song that's full of joy, which is from Mary Poppins, Let's Go Fly a Kite, and which is a great song. And if you know the whole thing, you're welcome to sing along for the whole thing, but I could only really fit the chorus, the Let's Go Fly a Kite part. So if you want to just jump in for the chorus, that's fine. If you want to do the whole thing, that's fine too. I'll give us a little intro and then.
Yeah.
Hopefully now you're all feeling that glow of joy right now. My opening words are from Matt Benny, a practitioner of Buddhism, who shared this personal observation. I spent years searching for joy. For a long time, I thought that if I did the same things I saw in movies and on TV, I'd become a joyful person. I also learned from my environment that I'd be happy when I acquired enough material abundance. I got the toys I wanted and waited for joy to happen. I hoped that a new bicycle, new skis, a new TV in my room, and brand new Nikes would give me all the happiness I craved, but they didn't. Well, they did, but it didn't last for long. I felt joy for a while, or at least I thought I felt it. Next, I thought I'd feel free and independent if I had a new apartment. When I got that, I'd enjoy life. That lasted for a month or two, and then I got used to that. I can go on, but I think you get the point. I was always pursuing joyfulness, but never actually feeling it for long. What was I doing wrong? I was walking the paths that were supposed to lead to joy, right? Then something occurred to me. What if I'm already on the joy way? Hold on, sorry. What if I'm already on the joy way? Wherever I go, it leads me through joy, joyful cities, joyful adventures, joyful challenges. At that point, I started simplifying my life. I stopped putting as much emphasis on how much I learned, earned, what kind of vacations I took, and what I could buy. Instead, I found joy in reading books, being in nature, and spending time with great friends. It felt strange at first, but trying this new approach turned out to be a smart choice. If I compare my life now and a few years back, it's obvious I'm far happier now. The core principle for me is that joyfulness is always available, regardless of my circumstances. I don't go and reach for the joy. I don't hunt the joy. I don't pursue the joy. I simply embrace it. Joyfulness is a lot like air. The air is always there. You just have to breathe it in. Which brings me to my own reflection on joy. Three letters that contain immense feeling. To begin, I invite you to close your eyes and picture a joyful memory. Imagine what your face looked like in that moment and try to remember the feelings that filled you and where in your body you felt joy. When I close my eyes, I remember the first time holding my children. There were so many emotions, but joy was primary. Overwhelming the fear, the pain, the uncertainty that were also present. Looking into my son's eyes as I held him and later my daughter's, my heart was filled to bursting with love and happiness. It was a euphoric sensation that filled my whole body with warmth. I'm pretty sure it wasn't just the epidural causing that. The thing is, joy is a fleeting emotion, like a strip of magnesium burning brightly and gone in a comparative flash. But oh boy, the intense glow it creates. It's addictive in a way, and we can't wait for the next jolt. So what gets in the way of feeling joy? The National Institute of Mental Health reports that nearly 10% of the US population is diagnosed with depression, with teens being the fastest growing subgroup in that category. There are, of course, many challenges to experiencing joy, and depression is just one of them. As human beings, it is inevitable that we will experience loss, sorrow, uncertainty, disappointment, frustration, and other unpleasant emotions. Obstacles are thrown in our life's journey on a regular basis, which can make joy seem more elusive. Some of us seem to face an unfair number of challenges, yet we continue the pursuit of joy as a universal human endeavor. It's a natural desire to increase our happiness and joy and decrease sadness and uncertainty. So how do we increase the odds of feeling joy? There are a number of books written on this topic, and I've read many of them in my personal journey. I began reading about joy and happiness to overcome the many challenges and losses in my own life. I was diagnosed with major depressive disorder around 2001 when I lost my dad and my older brother to different forms of cancer within 6 months of each other. My new brother-in-law had suffered a fatal heart attack that same year, just before the events of 9/11. By all rights, I could have crawled into bed and stayed there. However, I had a classroom full of kids relying on me and a mom and sisters who needed me to be strong with them. So I sought treatment and also began a spiritual and intellectual journey that led me to understand how mindset and simple things could improve my life. Simultaneously, I recognized the importance of fostering more joy in my classroom with my students. It took time to figure out what worked for me and then even longer to put it into regular practice. But with intention and repetition, joyfulness became a regular part of my outlook. Today, I will share some wisdom with all of you from these two especially insightful books, wisdom that has fueled my daily practice of joy. The first comes from the Book of Joy. This book chronicles a week-long visit between the Archbishop Desmond Tutu and His Holiness the Dalai Lama in Dharamsala, India. These aged spiritual leaders enjoyed a long friendship as well as similar ideals and goals. They were also both known for being smiley and possessing a profound capacity for joy, even through the many hardships they had faced. I found it interesting that in one part, Archbishop Tutu marveled at the ability of the Dalai Lama to maintain a joyful state of mind despite being exiled from his homeland and people for decades. The Dalai Lama responded to this observation by relating a lesson he learned from the 8th century Buddhist master, Shantideva. The gist of the lesson was this: if something can be done about the situation, what need is there for dejection? And if nothing can be done about it, what use is there for being dejected? That struck me, a worrier by nature, as oversimplified, but rational. It reminded me of something else that I'd learned in one of the many professional development sessions I attend as an educator. It's called the circle of control. In this exercise, you consider one thing bothering you or stressing you out. For example, will my new boss like me? Did I make a right decision in choosing a new job? Having started a new job in a new building this year, after 26 years of being in the classroom, I took a job as a librarian. I spent most of my summer worrying about that very decision. But then I remembered to ask the question, is this something within my circle of control? The answer, of course, was no, since I can't control whether my boss likes me or not. However, what is in my control is my ability to be pleasant and professional when performing my job, which improves the chances of a favorable impression made on my boss. Besides, my focus is on helping the kids and the teachers get the most out of library. Once you determine something is outside your circle of control, it doesn't make sense to expend your energy trying to control it. So you let it go or shift your energy to something you can affect more directly. In my experience, this can lead to a feeling of lightening, which makes more space for experiencing joy. With practice, I've become better about recognizing what needs to be let go, although I still have to put in an intentional effort to actually accomplish the letting go. The Dalai Lama also said that negative emotions don't overwhelm him, in part because of his ability to have compassion for others. He said, when we see these things, we realize that not only do we suffer, but so do many of our human brothers and sisters. So when we look at the same event from a wider perspective, we will reduce the worrying and our own suffering. In other words, as we recognize others' suffering and realize we are not alone, our pain is lessened. We see this all of the time when people raise money, like we're working on, to help the earthquake victims, or people change their Facebook profile picture to show support for things like the Michigan State shooting that happened last week. It's our attempt to connect and show compassion and make sense of something that seems so senseless. The Dalai Lama's statement bears repeating. When we see these things, we realize that not only do we suffer, but so do many of our human brothers and sisters. So when we look at the same event from a wider perspective, we will reduce the worrying and our own suffering. So this made me think of this congregation and all communities, really. The essence is that feeling alone and focusing inward causes greater pain. Focusing outward and being part of a group, even naming yourself a fellow human being, can lessen the pain. Being connected to someone or something is part of the building of the foundation of joy, which is where my second book comes in, The Atlas of the Heart by Brene Brown. Anyone read that one? No? Okay, I highly recommend it. I discovered it last summer and listened to it while driving to Northern Michigan and back by myself. Brene is a researcher, a professor at the University of Houston, and a management leader. She has spent decades researching emotions and how they play out in all aspects of our lives. In Atlas, she does an amazing job explaining how groups of emotions are connected and how they manifest. I could go on and on about Brene, but I will respect all of our time and limit my gushing to her discussion about the integral relationship between gratitude and joy. In her book, Brene defines joy as sudden, unexpected, short-lasting, and high intensity. It's characterized by a connection with others or with God, nature, or the universe. Joy expands our thinking and attention, and it fills us with a sense of freedom and abandon. The most important word in that definition, in my opinion, is connection. Did some of you hear that word pop out at you as I read that? One or two. Connection is what Sunday service is all about. So are the drum circles and the blood drives and the RE program and the circle dinners, the food donations, the celebrations held within these walls. They're all about connection. That's where joy lives. Brene blew my mind a few paragraphs later when I read, researchers describe the relationship between joy and gratitude as an intriguing upward spiral. Gratitude predicts greater future experiences of in-the-moment joy. Joy predicts greater future experiences of in-the-moment gratitude. Situational joy predicts greater future subjective well-being. It's a different kind of circle of life. So why does gratitude lead to joy? I've done a lot of thinking about that. When you think about how when you're feeling grateful for something, it's taking up all the space in your brain for that moment. This is also, of course, being mindful. By recognizing the value of someone or something outside of yourself, it creates a sense of community and connection, and that connection leads to the possibility of joy. And I say possibility of joy because it has to be seized upon. It has to be acted upon. You have to reach out and recognize it and accept it. Because not every moment of gratitude will lead to joy otherwise. But the gratitude that is felt with intention more often does lead to you feeling joy. As I mentioned before, I'm a teacher as well as a librarian, but teaching can be really stressful, as some of you know, and it can be overwhelming when you're responsible for the growth and well-being of 22 to 32 young people day in and day out. In the past several years, my teacher besties and I have made a point to find joy every day to counteract that stress and that level of feeling sometimes hopeless that things will get better. We hope to foster it in others, but it has to start with us. We want the kids to be joyful, but we have to model that. So here's how we did that. Sometimes I would go back into their official files, the kids' official files, and see their pictures from the time they were kindergartners up until the time they were fourth grade when I had them. So seeing those almost as tall as me, sassy, sometimes smelly and loud kiddos who were irritating me that day, seeing them as little kids with gap-toothed smiles or teeny tiny teeth in their smiles helped me put things into perspective. I may be angry about something a kid did when I go in, but when I come out, it's much easier to see them for the individual little humans they are, and to recognize that they need my words and actions to come from a place of love. Another thing we did to find joy, we wrote down or texted each other little gems that kids said throughout the day. And if I was smart, I'd collect those and do my second career as a stand-up comedian or writing memoirs, but I'm not that smart. Instead, they serve a purpose of in the moment joy and gratitude and making us grateful for our job, which is we get to be around little people all day who find immense joy in the smallest of things. Like, I saw a ladybug today. That is the highlight of their day, and it becomes my highlight as well. Finally, the last thing we would do is, and this year it hasn't happened because I'm in a new building, but we would do 5-minute dance parties, just like we did at the beginning of the service today. One of us would play upbeat music in our classroom sound system, which could get very loud, and it would carry out into the hall, and we danced and sang as kids made their way into the room in the morning. We'd check in with them, and smiles would be on our faces, and they'd be rolling their eyes at the crazy teachers who were dancing and singing their way in. But that was okay, because they always had smiles on their faces by the time they walked in. And my looking ridiculous, if that made them feel happy, then that was okay with me. So the joy is not the same every day that I find. Sometimes it's triggered by dozens of different things. It might be seeing the sun peek out from behind clouds, or it might be the color of the sky, or it might be someone smiling and saying hi as they go past me. What really makes the difference is setting the intention that you will find joy in your day and keeping your mind and heart open to it and looking for those opportunities. If it eludes you, then practice authentic gratitude, because the gratitude will lead to the joy. So here's my daily practice for gratitude and joy. Notice something or someone around you. Really consider what they mean to you and why you're glad to have them in your life. Notice the qualities that you cherish in that person or place or thing. And soon you will notice that same warmth spreading through you that you always feel when you feel joy. It can fill your heart and sometimes your eyes with a nice shining joy. So thank you for letting me tell you a little bit about joy and sharing some of the wisdom from these books.
Megan, or whoever's over by the computer, if you wouldn't mind going back to the browser for a second so that we can, again, get some lyrics. Yep. So this is a song that I haven't heard played on the radio or anywhere else in a while, but this is a great joy song by Paul Simon and Art Garfunkel. It's more commonly known as Feeling Groovy, but I think the official title is the 59th Street Bridge Song. And it's less of the let's go fly a kite joy of the let's connect in the moment, and more the slow down and enjoy the things that are around you, the more connect with nature, connect with what's around you style of joy. So the lyrics are, if you wouldn't mind scrolling down a tiny bit, I think we can fit the whole thing, no problem, but I think we got it, right? It's just three verses, it's really short. And if you know it, sing along. If not, enjoy and listen. Let's see. Enjoy. Okay, good. Slow down, you're moving too fast. You got to make the morning last now. They're kicking down the cobblestones, looking for fun and feeling groovy. Da, 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 da. no rhymes for me. I didn't do a feeling groovy. Ah, da, 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 da. Feeling groovy. I got no deeds to do, no promises to keep. I'm dappled and drowsy and ready to sleep. Let the morning time drop all its petals on me. Life, I love you. All is groovy.
Now we pass our offertory basket. I want to remind everyone that our donations today and from last week are going to help the victims of the earthquakes in Syria and Turkey. Now is the time for sharing of joys, concerns, and milestones. Bob, would you please pause the recording?
Thanks, everybody, for writing.
So I think you know how this works by now. We'll take just a moment to take a moment of silence. And if you wish to breathe along in time with the chords, you are welcome to do so. And if your rhythm is slightly different, that's fine too.
So, closing words today come from Archbishop Desmond Tutu. He said, "Perhaps our synagogues, our temples, and our churches are not as welcoming as they should be," which connects to what David was just talking about, right? "I really think that we do need for these fellowships to do a great deal more to have those who are lonely come and share. Not in an aggressive way, or in order, as it were, to increase their records and their ranks, but really just keenly interested in one person who comes and gets what they did not have before, warmth and fellowship," end quote. So I chose this because I feel that this mission that he mentions is akin to the one here at MVUUC. You welcome seekers into your midst and invite connection with your community in the spirit of discovery and fellowship. My hope is that as you increase your outreach efforts, you include an intentional practice of gratitude for the accomplishments, big and small, the connections, singular or numerous, that you achieve. Appreciate the moments of joyful human connection for the treasures they are, and you will be living life more fully.
Now is the time for announcements. And I'll start. Hang on, let me do mine and then I'll go to you. Blood drive, March 4th, 9 to 2. Looking for donors, looking for volunteers to help clean up. And I appreciate everybody who helps at the blood drive, both donating blood and also volunteering. It really helps me out. I really appreciate it.
Tonight's another drum circle from 5 to 6. And also, I cleaned off all my bookshelves and brought a bunch of books that are out in the social hall. Help yourself to whatever looks interesting. And when you're done reading it, if you want to bring it back, we can kind of get a lending library going, or just keep it and pass it on to your friends, whatever you would like to do with those books.
I'll be all right. My announcement is this Tuesday night, Amanda Cook, who's a member of this congregation, is going to be doing the BGSU Science Cafe, which I am the host of the BGSU Science Cafe. It's on Zoom. You do have to register, though. I put a link on the private discussion board on Facebook, but I can also share a link individually. Just like let me know. I can share a link for how to register for that. Or if you just search BGSU Science Cafe, you should find it. She's giving a talk on her research on healthcare industry and where we get our health insurance. So that's the research she does. So yeah. And it's I could say it's a short talk that's aimed at the general public, followed by 30 minutes of discussion and questions and answers. And she has a panel there of like students she works with and collaborators she works with too. So it's not like maybe a more traditional just talk kind of thing. It's really fun and interactive. Yeah. I tore my Achilles. So it's gonna be some time for me to heal, but I'm okay. I will be. Fencing. I've been fencing since 1996, so but this is the first time that's happened.
I'm somewhat guilty of joys and concerns. Apparently, you're not supposed to talk about or make mention of the sermons. I mean, the sermons are so fantastic, I can't help myself. We're supposed to meet afterwards. I've never seen anything in writing where we're supposed to meet to talk about the sermon, but I recommend that we meet right over there. And if anybody has any joys that they've experienced or something like that or whatever, I think it would be good. And I think it's good that we have a little discussion of the sermon afterwards. That's my opinion. I hope you agree. So we meet a specific place, and I understand is it over there? Somebody said if we meet out there, I suggest right here.
So that's what happens after service. Before service, we're restarting the adult discussion group. We had three people there this morning. We'd like to have more. If you feel like coming an extra hour early or even a half hour, however early you want to get here. But we pretty much solve all the world's problems in 1 hour. And then, of course, in the coming week, more problems show up. So we have something to talk about the following week. Yes. Yeah, we're meeting in the social hall. We used to meet in one of the RE rooms, but there aren't enough chairs in there, so we're just meeting out in the social room.
Yeah. But,
yes, yes.
And we meet an hour before church.
An hour before church like we used to, yeah.
Ford, you remind me that before the pandemic, we were trying to regularly do that. The Sunday Services Committee had started, had implemented a plan that after the services, we would have the discussion. And then the pandemic hit and we went Zoom and it became difficult to do that, and we hadn't re-implemented it. So I will remind the Sunday Services Committee about that and let them know that there is interest in doing that again. And we can see if we can get that started after every service again, if people have interest in it. Thank you. Please join me in reading the words for extinguishing our chalice that can be found in your order of service or in the Zoom chat box. As we extinguish this flame, we affirm that we are wanted, we are loved, and we are grateful for the warmth of our small but mighty community. After the closing song, we invite everyone in person to stay for coffee hour.
So for our closing song today, I thought we'd do a little joyful twist on Country Road, Take Me Home. And that the twist is that I'd like you guys, when we get to the chorus, instead of saying West Virginia, we're gonna say Northwest Ohio. So that's the first replacement. Instead of Mountain Mama, we'll say Black Swamp Mama. So I'll take the verses. You're welcome to sing on the verses if you know the words, but otherwise the chorus, I think everybody will know. So when we get to the chorus, it's Northwest Ohio instead of West Virginia and Black Swamp Mama instead of Mountain Mama. We'll get there. You'll get a couple passes around. Almost heaven, Northwest Ohio.
Take me home to the place I belong.